Okay, so let's start. What we're going to do today is we're going to use these two tools right here. This is the fundamental theorem of calculus. We know that integration and differentiation is like addition and subtraction. You add something, you subtract, you get back where you started. Here, I integrate something, I differentiate, I'm right back where I started. Second thing that we're going to use a lot today is the chain rule. And I gave you a story for the chain rule. I didn't give you a multivariable chain rule. That'll be on your exercises for tonight. But a multivariable chain rule is very important because you have to know how to take a problem, a given problem, and how to find what are the component parts. How are they affecting what's going on? Because remember, I said that it divides. What the chain rule does is not just a tool. It is a conceptual tool, which divides what you're talking about into the component parts. What's going on with each of the parts. Alrighty. What I want to do first is state that the probability of y less than or equal to y is equal to the integral from minus infinity to y of the PDF du. Okay? So that's what we have. We have that if I find what's the probability from minus infinity to y, that's called a cumulative distribution function. And what does it give me? It is just what it says. I'm just adding up all of the probabilities from minus infinity up to y. And that's what I'm doing here. And now what do we do? If I find what is the derivative with respect to y of the probability of y less than or equal to y, what do I get? I get f back again. Thank you. I get f right back again from the top line over there. So this will be f of y. And this is the tool that we're going to use today to learn how to create a large number of other PDFs, probability distribution functions. Okay, so let's see how we're going to do this. Let's start off with the following problem. Where y is equal to sigma x plus mu. Where x is a normal distribution, zero mean, one variance. What is y? What's the variance of y? We did this last time. What's the variance of y?
Sigma squared.
And what's the mean? Mu. And so therefore, what we have is that y is a normal distribution with mean mu and variance sigma squared. What we want to do is we want to derive the PDF, the probability distribution function. I don't want you to memorize it. It's so easy to derive that it's easier to derive than it is to remember. So how do we do this? Excuse me. Well, we know right here. I'm trying to find what this is. So I want to find what's the probability that y is less than or equal to y. If I can figure this out, all I have to do is differentiate then, and I have the PDF. Okay, everybody with me on that? That's just what we have already done twice. Okay, and so now the trouble is, I don't know much about y. So let's change its name. This is Robert, this is Mike, this is Bob. So Bob is sigma x plus mu is less than or equal to y. So I start off with what I want. Convert it into what I know. Now what I have to do is I have to get this in terms of x. So to get this in terms of x, what I'm going to do is I subtract mu from both sides. So I'm going to have y minus mu, and I'm going to divide by sigma. And now I have the probability that I want to know is in terms of something I know about. And what is this? This is equal to 1 over root 2 pi, the integral from minus infinity to y minus mu over sigma e to the minus x squared over 2 dx. Everybody with me on this? Okay. So see, what we're doing is we start with what we want to know, the probability that y is less than or equal to small y. Don't know that at all. So what I do then is I replace Robert with Bob, with y's name, and then I just solve for x. And what I have is this equation here, and I now know what the answer is going to be. So now I know that if I'm going to differentiate, that means I'm going to differentiate this thing right here. If I differentiate this right here, I'm going to be using the chain rule. F is the value of the integral, f, and this is the upper limit. And so therefore it'll be f prime. So this will be e to the minus. What do I write in parentheses? I write what g of y is according to the chain rule. So that will be y minus mu over 2 squared, over sigma, excuse me, over sigma squared divided by 2. Times the derivative of g, and that's going to be just 1 over sigma. And this is true for y between minus infinity and infinity. Okay, everybody see that? So what we have then is we now know what the PDF is for a general representation of a normal distribution. And see, it's very easy. Much easier to derive it than it is to remember. Okay? So let's go through that again, because I'm going to ask you to do a problem next. The trick is I want to know what is the PDF for y. There's y, and I want to know what's its PDF. To find its PDF, I have to compute the cumulative distribution function. I have to take y and write down how its definition. And then I want to solve for what I do know, x. And that's what I get here. Once I have this, I now know what is the cumulative distribution function of this. All I have to do is differentiate this now, and we already went through the chain rule several times, and we have this right here, over here, And this is true for y between minus infinity and infinity. Notice what that integrand is. Notice what, exponent is. Y minus mu over sigma. This is essentially the z statistic, isn't it? Because remember, the z statistic is going to be y minus mu over sigma. And what I get is small y minus mu over sigma, quantity squared over 2, 1 over sigma in the front. I got that fudge factor in the front so that the integral is 1. Okay, everybody have that? Okay, I'm going to give you a problem now, and we will work it out in a few minutes. The problem is, y equals x squared. X is normally distributed with variance 1. Remember, we had delta x. We had delta x on the problem last time, delta x quantity squared, and we said we needed to know what's the PDF. Now we're going to find the PDF of y equals x squared. So go ahead and do that. Okay, to get on this, what we have is the probability of y less than or equal to y. If I can compute what this is, I can then just differentiate this and I will find the PDF for y. Okay, now, how do we do that? First of all, what do we know about y? We know, first of all, that y has to be greater than or equal to 0. Because y is equal to x squared. And so therefore, I can write 0 is less than or equal to y. That is, 0 is less than or equal to x squared less than or equal to y. And that leads us to, well, I got to get this back. See, what I've done now is I start with what I want. I substituted the name. The next step is strictly to solve it in terms of x. And this is going to equal the probability of minus root y is less than or equal to x is less than root y. Okay, and I know what that's equal to. That is equal to 1 over root 2 pi. The integral from minus root y to root y e to the minus x squared over 2 dx. Okay? And now, I know how to differentiate that. You do, because you had to do so for your homework for today. And so, therefore, we have that the derivative with respect to y of p of, p of y less than or equal to y is equal to 1 over root 2 pi e to the minus y over 2 times the derivative of that. That is going to be 1 half y to the 1 half power minus this lower limit e to the minus y over 2 times a minus 1 half root y, which is equal to 1 over root 2 pi times the 1 halves cancel, become 1, and I have e to the minus y over 2 times over root y for y greater than or equal to 0. Actually, greater than 0, it's not defined at 0. Okay, so you see how to get these. Actually, very simple. Let me ask a question. Why are you interested in x squared? I mean, you told me today you're really interested in x squared. Why are you interested in x squared? I love that answer, because it's pretty. Okay, pretty close. What happens is that suppose I have along a line, I'm dropping things, you know? I mean, or I got a line over there and I'm just whipping chalk across the room and trying to hit the certain thing there. Okay, and I find the mean. Okay, here's the mean. And some hit above, some hit below. I'm interested in knowing how far from the bullseye am I hitting. So x will tell me if I'm below or above. X squared will be the distance squared of how far I miss the target, the bullseye. And so what we have then is that we have to expect that this variable y equals x squared to play a role in much of what we do. Indeed, we already have delta x is n 0 delta t, and we have to handle delta x squared. Any questions? Okay, let's try one more. Suppose I have y equals x cubed. Y equals x cubed, where n, x is a normal distribution. We're going to try the natural log of y equals x later on, probably Thursday, because it's going to play a role. So now try y equals x cubed. To get started, I have that the probability, we start with what I want to know, the probability that y is less than or equal to y. And then I write what is its definition. X cubed is less than or equal to y. Now, what are the values that y can have? You got the answer. Go ahead, say it. Yeah, all the way from minus infinity to infinity. You can have any value. If y is negative, then the cube root is going to be the negative value. If y is positive, it can be almost anything. And so what we have here, it's that y ranges between minus infinity and infinity. So therefore, and the reason I state that is this is going to differ from what we have over there. Because now I'm going to have the probability of x less than or equal to y to the 1/3 power. I don't have the lower bound, because if I had squared, I'd have the lower bound. I have the upper but here, I can go all the way. So if this is equal to minus 1, then I can have any value of x, minus 75, whatever you want. If this is 5, well, y cubed to the 1/3 power is 5, this can be all the negative values, everything else you want. So I know that this is equal to 1 over root 2 pi, the integral from minus infinity to y to the 1/3 power, e to the minus x squared over 2 dx. And when I differentiate this, the derivative with respect to y of the probability that y is less than or equal to y is then going to be 1 over root 2 pi from I don't have any integrals here. I have e to the minus y to the 2/3 power over 2 times 1 times 1/3 y to the minus 2/3 power. And this is defined everywhere from minus infinity to infinity except 0. 0, it gets a big bang. Okay? Any questions? So now if I gave you y equals x to the 4th power, you know what to do. Y, any of these, you know what to do. And in fact, this is a way in which a lot of probability distribution functions are computed. So you got to know it. And we're going to use it, as I said, on Thursday when we're trying to find the PDF for an asset. All right. That's that. Any questions on this? Because we're going to leave this go to the side until we come back to it when we need it on Thursday. Okay. Let's now jump into what is going to be a very important topic. A tool that you're going to need to know quite well. And I'm not going to write down the theorem. We'll figure out what it has to be. The result is our lemma. And this is the Ito lemma. And what I'm interested in doing is I have a function I have a smooth function, f of st. What does smooth mean? Yeah, you can differentiate, yeah. Kind of smooth, no big gaps in it. Then the derivative is doesn't have any big gaps or any bounces in it. So smooth is just a mathematician's way of saying, I'm too lazy to say that you can differentiate it two times or three times. Smooth just means you can differentiate it as many times as you need to get the answer. That's all it means, okay? So I have a smooth function, and notice what it's going to be. The smooth function is going to be a function of the asset price and time. And with delta S equal mu S delta T plus sigma S delta X is normally distributed with mean 0 and delta t, then delta f of s t equals, and we'll fill this in a little while. For small t, okay. Now let's find out who gives a darn. The reason you give a darn is that if you're going to talk about creating a portfolio, you know that your portfolios are functions of what? Of calls, puts, stock, etc. So F is going to represent the various portfolios that you have. What you want to know, if you want to become rich, is you want to know how that portfolio is going to change in value. You want to know how will that portfolio change in value. And so therefore, delta F says that if F of ST is my portfolio, consisting of calls, puts, stock, whatever you want, that the change in that portfolio is going to be given by the equation we're going to derive. Okay, any questions on this? Okay, so let's see what's going to be. Where does the idea come from? The idea comes from Taylor series. And this is why we studied Taylor series with two variables, why you had a lot of homework problems on it, you had a test problem on it, etc. So what we're going to have is the change in F, we know, has to be the partial of F with respect to S, the change in S, and I know what the change of S is, plus the partial of F with respect to t, the change in t, that's the first order terms, plus, now we get to the second order terms, 1 over 2 factorial, the second partial of f with respect to s, delta s squared, plus the second partial of f with respect to s, with respect to t, delta s, delta t, plus 1 over 2 factorial, the second partial of f with respect to t, delta t squared. Plus, we'll forget the other terms. They're too darn small. So in other words, it's a Taylor series approximation. Now, I don't know if you know it, but I have a Lamborghini. Oh, does that thing, oh, wow, does it move. It's going across campus, you know, with my Lamborghini, putting it downshifting and shooting across. No, not really. Now, If I get hit, my beautiful, beautiful Lamborghini, if it gets hit by a pebble, I'm crushed. If it gets hit by a fly, so I got to wipe off the, won't have guts to do that again, so I just wipe off the, wipe off the mess, and what we do is we have nothing. Now, what am I talking about this? If delta t is small, what about delta t squared? It's essentially negligible. So if delta t is 1 over 100, then delta t squared is, oh, come on, that's that little bug that just landed on my windshield. Delta t might give me a little dent on my Lamborghini, but delta t squared is, who gives a darn? Just wipe off that mess. Okay? So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to keep only larger terms. Keep delta t level terms. Okay, so let's do that. Well, what about this? You're right, that's minuscule. We can get rid of that. Let's just toss that away. That's that little fly on my windshield of my Lamborghini as I'm whipping across campus. Now, we take a look at this term, delta s delta t. Well, here's delta s. Well, I'm going to get a delta t squared. When I multiply delta s by delta t, I'm going to get a delta t squared. And I'm going to get a delta x delta t. But delta x is, that's pretty darn small too. You know, the variance and everything, that's very small. So we can throw that away. That's another Lamborghini fly hitting the windshield. By the way, I pick on Lamborghinis. I have a friend who lives in Vienna, and he had a red and a yellow Lamborghini. I mean, how many people have ever known anyone that owns one Lamborghini? He had two. Okay. So anyway, what we have is we got rid of these two terms. Now I have to get rid of anything more. Well, what did I have? Darn, I got to find this delta S squared. That's even worse. So let's compute what that is. Delta S squared is equal to mu S delta T plus sigma S delta X squared. So what I'm doing here is I'm computing this to find out if I can throw away any terms. Okay, and when I multiply that out, I'm going to get mu squared, s squared, delta t squared, plus 2 mu sigma, s squared, delta t, delta x, plus sigma squared, S squared delta X squared. And now we throw away those fly spots, the specks. If I throw away the specks, I get rid of this delta. This is too small to worry about. We've already said this is too small to worry about. What about delta x squared? What about delta x squared? Think back on your notes from just the day before the exam. If you look back on your notes just the day before the exam, we asked to find what is the expected value of delta x squared. And remember, the variance of delta x is equal to the expected value of delta x squared minus the expected value of delta x squared, and this is equal to zero. So therefore, this is equal to delta t. And we stated in class that as delta t gets small, with probability 1, that expected value of delta x squared is going to equal delta t. That this term right here is going to start hanging around and being delta t. That's what it's going to be. So what does that mean? That means we can now fill in the answer. That this is going to equal the partial of f with respect to s, delta s, plus the partial of f with respect to t, delta t, plus 1 over 2 sigma squared s squared, the second partial of f with respect to s, delta t. Okay, everybody with me on that? Okay, and this is Ito's lemma. This is Ito's lemma. This is the lemma. This is the term that we're going to use on Thursday to derive the Blac-Scholes equation. Or probably at the end of Thursday, depending on how much I get done in the first part of Thursday. But this is important. It's Ito's lemma. If you're ever looking at any type problem, and if you're at UCI in any course of mathematics or economics or physics or anything else, you're looking at these problems, where the lead term is mu s delta t, where the lead term is mu s delta t, like interest times money times time, plus a random effect, you're going to need something equivalent to Ito's lemma. Okay, any questions? All right. Now what we can do is explain to you a little bit about why we have delta x is normally distributed 0 delta t. I want you to go through and derive Ito's lemma with the following condition. Instead of delta t, it is equal to delta t to the 1/2 power. Is equal to delta t to the 1/2 power. So go ahead, derive Ito's lemma. So remember, you have to check to see what is the large term and what terms do you drop. It's the small, minuscule terms. And what's on red on that far panel is the hint to solve this problem. Because you have to replace delta x squared is what you have to do. Okay? And what we will have here is we go through and find what is small. Well, delta t is right here. This is around delta t size. There's a delta t. There's a delta t squared, so it doesn't matter. We know this is going to be small, so we can drop that. That's fly spec on my car. And we also know that this right here is going to be small. It's another fly spec on my car. No dents at all, just a fly spec. Now, what we have to do is we have to figure out what is delta S. Delta S is going to be equal to mu squared S squared delta T squared. That's why I left this here. Plus 2 mu S squared delta T delta X. Plus sigma squared S squared delta X squared. And what does this give me? Well, we now know that so far the largest term I have is delta t, and so therefore this is minuscule, this is minuscule, I got to figure out what this is. And what is that equal to? What's that equal to? Delta x squared, what's it equal to? Square root of delta t. Very good, very good. So what happens is she says, hey, we're just doing the same thing. If I have the square root and I'm looking at the variance, all I'm going to do is put the 1/2 right here and I go through here and that's what I have here. And so what we have is this right here now is going to be replaced by delta t to the 1/2 power. So what is the largest term of what we have here? What's the large term and what is a minuscule term? Because what I'm going to have here is I'm going to put in this right here is going to be replaced by 1 over 2, the second partial of f with respect to s all times sigma squared s squared delta t to the 1/2 power. What's the largest term in this relationship I have right here? What? Let's suppose delta t is equal to 100. 1 over 100, rather. What's delta t to the 1/2 power? One tenth, yeah. So therefore, if delta t is equal to, say, is equal to 1 over 100, delta t to the 1/2 power is equal to 1/10. 1/10 is much larger than 1/100. 1/100. So if I'm going to be dropping the small terms, what is it that I will do? I'm going to throw out. Now I'm going to, this will be saved. This will be saved. This will be thrown out. This will be thrown out, and that'll be thrown out. Oh, that might hang out here. And so what do? Is I get something with no drift. I get something with no drift. And so the, yes?
Why is delta x?
A little louder.
Why is delta x equal to the square root of delta t?
Okay, let's go over that again. What happens is, remember, I'm not looking at this problem here. I'm looking at this problem right here. Okay? And so what do I have? In this problem, I know that delta t to the 1/2 power is equal to the variance of delta x. Correct? And the variance is equal to the expected value of delta x squared minus this right here. This is 0. So I know that delta x squared is expected to act like delta t to the 1/2 power. That's its expected value. And in fact, it's going to hang around very closely when we look at the variance. And so therefore, with this problem, we have that this term right here, now becomes not delta t, but delta t to the 1/2 power. Okay? So when I substitute that in, that now becomes a gorilla in the room. That's the dominating term. And these other terms are dominant. And we throw away so many terms, we're throwing away the drift term, we're throwing away all sorts of terms, which we know have to play a role. You know, if you look at the stock market going up, we're throwing away the curve. That's silly. Okay. And if you look at delta t equals, if you look at the variance the other way, you're throwing away all the random terms. So the reason we have, so the very strong reason we have that this is the variance. Remember we started off and I said, why is that? I said, there's no real reason why that should be so. Why is that? And the answer is simple. With Ito's lemma. If you don't have delta t, you have delta t to some other power. What you will be doing is throwing away information that we know has to play a role. We're either throwing away the random fluctuation, it's like looking at your line, we're either throwing away the drift, and we know that the drift, you know, the way the curve is going, we know that has to play a role. So either we're throwing that away, or we're throwing away the fluctuations, and we know that has to play a role. And so therefore, for modeling reasons, to have an answer that makes some sense, we have to have delta t. Not delta t to any other power. Okay? Any questions? Now, some books write C delta t. That's silly. C for silly. Isn't that how you spell silly? And the reason it's silly is because you can just take out the C and put it into the sigma. And put it into the sigma, because that's just going to change your variance. You can throw it out in the front of the sigma, with the sigma, and it's not necessary. So the best way of doing it is with delta t. Any questions? All righty. What we're going to do now, I got more done than I thought. You people aren't asking many questions. Told you, put your seatbelts on. Okay. What we're going to do now is we're going to use all of this. Okay, let's do one more problem here. Let's do this problem right here. Fine, eat, yes?
Could you please explain again why it must be delta t?
Why what?
Why the variance must be delta t.
Okay. If it's delta t to a fractional power smaller than 1, what's going to happen?
The
drift term is going to disappear. And if it's larger than 1, and that'll be in your homework. Okay, you already know what's going to be in your homework. If it's larger, then other terms that we know play a role are going to drop out. And you'll be computing what those other terms are as your homework tonight. And in fact, what'll drop out is the delta x term will drop out because that's going to be too small. And so one way, so when we look at the market and we look at how prices fluctuate, we have this, right? One way we're throwing away the drift. Well, that's silly. We know that's a mistake. And the other way, I'm throwing away the oscillations. And that's silly. We know there's a randomness effect on there. So to have a model that makes sense, it has to be delta t. Okay? Yeah. Random term. Yeah, and we're going to compute that in your homework tonight. Okay? Any questions? That's a good question. Yeah.
So that FS, delta FS of t is just the term that we found?
That you're going to compute. And let's do it right now. And I'll just give this one right here as your homework, and let's just take an example right now. So let's look, I skipped this, I'll put that on your homework, and let's use Ito's lemma. All right, here's a problem that clearly is of interest to you. And I often get people calling me from finance firms, something like that, dropping by and saying, how can I find, what is the probability distribution of an asset? What's the probability distribution of an asset? Oh, you're taking a picture. I'm sorry. I didn't realize what you were doing. Okay, what's the probability distribution of an asset? If you knew how likely the asset at a certain time is, if you knew how likely it is, boy, you got an advantage over him because he didn't bother paying attention, okay? And so what happens is you get more likely to get the right answers. What's the probability that I'll make money on it, or that's going to go up or it's going to go down? The problem is we have this delta S, et cetera. We have delta S equals mu s delta t plus sigma s delta x. Now, I suppose we could look back at our homework and say, how did I compute money? How did I compute money? How money will change with interest. And the way you did this is you divided by s. Equals mu delta t plus sigma delta x. And what I would like to do is I would like to sum this thing. Well, summation here is not prod. But what's the summation here? Well, let's see. If we're going to sum this thing right here, I'll say everybody on this, flip a coin. And we'll count the number of heads and the number of tails, and that'll tell us whether we're moving to the right or to the left. Right? That's a probability distribution. Then I'll say, okay, we found out how far we're going to move now. Flip a coin again. Okay, well, we got 35 heads and 40 Tails, okay, that tells us we move to the right, left. And that we move only a little bit to the left. Boy, that's hard. How in the heck are we going to get any answer here? How are we going to get an answer? And so the way we do this is with Ito's lemma. What Ito's lemma says is that, well, what does delta S over S remind me? It says, let's choose F of S T, and this goes back to your question of how do I know what to put in there. You put in whatever we're looking for. On Thursday, we're going to start looking at hedging, and we're going to throw portfolios in there. And we're going to use that to determine how the change of the value of the portfolio is going to come about. But today, I'm going to look at the asset, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to call this the natural log of S. I'm going to call this the natural log of S. Why the natural log of S? Because I would expect that delta S is going to look something like delta S over S. So I'm going to have delta F, which is equal to delta, the natural log of S, is going to equal, according to this, 1 over S, 1 over the natural log, times delta S plus 0, because the natural log of S does not have T explicitly, so that's not in there. This is the partial of the natural log. This right here is the partial of the natural log of S with respect to T. T's not there, so that's 0. Plus, now what we do is we have here 1/2 sigma squared S squared. And now I'm taking the second partial of F with respect to S. The first partial is 1 over S. The second partial is minus 1 over S squared. Delta T. Okay. And so now what we have, when I put everything in here, it's that the change in the natural log of S is equal to, I write in the delta S, that's what I have here, and notice all the S's cancel out. 1 over S times S over here. So that's going to be equal to mu delta T plus sigma delta X plus minus sigma squared over 2 delta T. And what we have then is, if I put this all together, I have that this is equal to mu minus sigma squared over 2 delta T plus sigma delta X. And that, where am I? Right here. Mu minus sigma squared over 2 delta T plus sigma delta X. Okay? Any questions on that? Let's see if I made a mistake. Sigma S. No, it looks right. Looks right. I think that's right. Okay? Any questions on that? Now I can integrate. No, I can't. I can't. Still can't integrate this thing. But maybe I can sum it. So let's try a summation. And what are we going to do? What I'm going to do is I'm going to sum these things, starting from T0 to T1 to T2, all the way to T. Tn equals T. Tnt. And so here's my little delta T's. So I'm going to sum that a relationship I have there, the delta natural log of S. Okay, so let's see what that is. What I'm going to have first, from here, I'm going to have the natural log of S of T1 minus the natural log of S of T0. Okay, this minus this, that's going to be equal to delta natural log of S, right? This minus that. Okay, everybody with me on this? Now I want to find the change here. That's going to be the natural log of S of T2 minus the natural log of S of T1. And if you've had integral calculus, you know what's going to happen on here. And this is going to be then the natural log of S of T3 minus the natural log of S of T2. The natural log of S of T minus the natural log of S of Tn minus 1. That's what that summation is going to equal. Any cancellations? Anybody see any cancellations? Where? Yeah. Right. He's saying, hey, look at this thing. Look how everything drops out. Here I have a T1 minus T1. That's going to drop out. Here I have a T2 minus T2. I'm going to have a T3 minus T3. And then I'm going to have this. Okay, everyone see that? And that's strictly because what am I doing? Is that each case I'm taking this minus this, then it'll be this minus this, then it'll be this minus this, all the way up. So what we have then is that the natural log of S of T, I want to know at time T what is going to be the value of the stock. Or what's the probability distribution for that value of the stock? Minus the natural log of S of T0, it's going to equal the summation of mu minus sigma squared over 2 delta t plus the summation of the delta x's. The reason this is important is I'm going to get a probability distribution. I'm going to get a probability distribution for the natural log of S of T. To show you where I'm headed, I'm going to get a probability distribution coming from this. And that probability distribution, I can find the PDF then, the same way we did it at the beginning of this hour and a half. Okay? Everybody with me here? Yes? Am I using what? Yeah, what I have here is, what I'm doing is I'm summing these right here. I have mu minus, I've summed all of these terms. So I'm going to be summing these terms, mu minus sigma squared, and summing all of these terms at each, over each interval. Now this right here is pretty easy. This right here is going to be just mu minus sigma squared over 2 t minus t0. Plus summing all of these fluctuations in the market. Question?
Where did your sigma go in front of the summation of delta A?
I think that you just didn't see it. It's right here. Thank you. Okay. That's where it is, right there. You just didn't see it. Okay. Any other questions? Any other corrections? Please keep me honest. All righty. Now what we're going to do is the only thing we have left to do is the following. It's that I have that the problem I have that the natural log of S of T is equal to the natural log of S of T0. This is the today's price of the market. Here's at time t, I want to know what the market is going to be doing. Plus mu minus 1/2 sigma squared t minus t0. Plus summation sigma delta x. All we have to do is figure out that last term. When we figure out that last term, we can say we've had a day, we can go home. So he's saying, hurry, hurry. All right? Any questions on what I have up there so far? Here's the theorem. Here's the theorem that allows us to solve, if I can find my pencil, there it is, that allows us to solve this result. The theorem is, that if I have a large number of xi's where xi's are normally distributed with mean mu I and sigma I squared variance, if this is true, and independent. Then the summation of the xi's is normally distributed with the mean of the summation of the mu i's and the variance, the summation of the sigma I squared. That's a result from probability and statistics. You're responsible for knowing it, you're not responsible for deriving it. And so what is this? This says, now notice what this says, and because here's another place where the assumptions we're making to get an answer are a little shaky, more than a little shaky. Because what is it we're saying? We're saying that delta x, this is the random fluctuation in this region. Here's the random fluctuation in this region. Here's the random fluctuation in this region. And we are going to add up all those random fluctuations. Do you really believe that the random fluctuations that happen in the market right now have no effect on what's going to happen now? Of course not. But that's what we're going to assume. Wow. Okay. We assume that to get an answer. Not true. But it might be true in some situations. This is one of the situations where I'm telling you, you be aware. Be aware if you go on the market, because there's so much we do not know. And there's so much that all of these nice equations and formulas that we write down, and we say, in this book, memorize this and do these problems, are nonsense. So be aware when there are troubles. Like efficient market hypothesis, for example, is not always true. And so what we have here is I'm going to assume that all of these things right here, all of these things right here, are independent. Are they independent? No way. But I'm going to assume it. And if I assume this, then I know that this right here is going to be normally distributed sum of a bunch of zeros. You sum a bunch of zeros and you don't get much. Okay? And then a sum of the delta t's, and I still got that sigma in front. And so what is it that we have? We have the following. I can get rid of some of this here now. We have that the natural log of S of t We have that the natural log of the price at time t is equal to the natural log of the price at the starting time. So this is going to tell you how that price is going to change. Plus mu minus 1/2 sigma squared t minus t zero. Plus y, where y is normally distributed with mean zero and variance sigma squared t minus t zero. This is precisely what we're going to use to find the probability distribution. We have this. Everybody knows where all these terms come from. We know where this comes from the summation. We know this comes from summing the t's. We know this comes from our weak assumption, weak in the sense I don't believe it, that all of these are independent so that I can use the theorem. And I get this right here. The sigma squared comes from taking this sigma that I keep forgetting and moving it inside, so I won't forget it. So what does this say? This says that the natural log of S of t, the natural log of S of t, is normally distributed with mean, natural log of S of t, 0 plus mu minus 1/2 a squared, there's their mean, and there's the variance. So to find the probability, so to find the probability that S of t, the value of the stock at a certain time, is less than or equal to some number S, if I know that, I can differentiate it. This is going to equal the natural log, the probability of the natural log of S of T is less than or equal to the natural log of S, and that is going to be equal to, now I just write down the probability distribution for this ugly thing right here and differentiate it. What ugliness? But hey, you get an answer, and you know how the value of the stock is going to change, and what do? You become rich, and you endow a chair for me. Thank you. All right? Any questions? We covered a lot today. Here's what we covered. We covered how... See, I keep forgetting that people have cameras to take pictures of notes on the board, so I got to get out of the way. So what have we covered? We reviewed how to find the probability distributions, or actually we found out how to find probability distributions from other functions. We found Ito's lemma. And from Ito's lemma, we used Ito's lemma to find what is the probability distribution of an asset. That's going to be a log normal distribution, and we'll talk about that at the beginning of Thursday. Now, two things. One, you know from the note I sent you, there will be an extra session tonight somewhere. I don't remember where anymore. Probably the same room we were before. And number two, that'll be from 6 to 7. And number two, the two of you who haven't taken your makeup, please see me after class. See you on Thursday.